Dr. Ellen Casey, one of the first female faculty members, arrived at Scranton in 1969.
In one way, there were a fair number of women, and obviously there were women on maintenance staff, on food staff, so there were women doing all sorts of jobs on campus. There were, of course, staff, largely secretaries. There were librarians. I think at that point, all of the librarians were women. I had a chair who was punctilious about using proper titles. And so everyone was Dr. Jones and the Reverend Father Dr. Smith. And then in that context, he would call me Mrs. Casey. So I went to see him in his office to suggest that I saw no reason why we were using degrees and titles, but if we were, then I wanted to be Dr. Casey, like everyone else was Dr. Whatever. And he apologized profusely and assured me that, of course, that's what he would do, and why would I ever think that I, you know, he was yada, yada, yada. Next meeting, of course, he called me Mrs. Casey. So I repeated my speech to him in public. He never did it again.
Dr. Karen Pennington was among the first undergraduate female students in 1972 before serving as our Associate Dean of Students.
The university became co-ed in 1972, and I was among the first class of women at the university. It was a very exciting time. It was a very challenging time for many of my peers as we began this really adventure. There were 50 women in Fitch Hall. That was the only building that had places on campus for women, and about 900 men. You would definitely be the only woman in many of your classes. If there was more than one, people would sit together. The women would congregate together for safety and protection. It was a very different experience to have that. But most of the men, I would say, between faculty, staff, fellow students, most men were very kind, supportive.
I was thinking about the Committee on the Status of Women, and I believe it was Jane Copus, who was a Franciscan sister, who first made the proposal that that committee be started.
The Campus Women's Center was established in 1996. It was later renamed for Sister Jane Copus, who brought attention to the needs of women in campus life.
Within our communities, we have had the experience of being leaders, and we've also had the experience of networking and learning how to do that and learning the value of it.
Women's studies at the University of Scranton started in its planning stages in the late 1980s, shortly before I arrived in 1989. In 1992, we actually launched the Women's Studies concentration. Women's Studies programs took off in the United States in the early 1970s, and they really served two primary purposes. The first was to provide theory and data to support the women's movement, and the second was to correct the bias that we found in teaching and scholarship across all colleges and universities. There was a third reason for women's studies, and that was that there had been an absolute blossoming of scholarship on gender and women's issues and feminism.
The Kenyan school, unlike the university as a whole, is 2/3 male and 1/3 female. The university as a whole has more females than males.
The University of Scranton has set up a fund which awards grants to projects specifically designed to increase diversity awareness.
So for example, we have a special program called the Women's Entrepreneurship Center. We need women as part of our diversity effort here. Without women, I think productivity, things like innovation, will stifle.
Dr. Marian Farrell explains the beginning of the emphasis on diversity.
I have this from a little note that came from Jane Copus that she'd found in her archive. So it is dated back in 1981. And it said that the Permanent Committee on the Status of Women, established in 1981 by the directive of the president, functions as an advisory board to the president. And I think that's really essential, particularly in light of some of the more recent discussions about what is the role of the Committee on the Status of Women. The purpose at that time was to support the goals of the university and its commitment to excellence by striving to enhance women's participation and contributions and to help to create an atmosphere in which women will be recognized and encouraged to realize their potentials. And I think that's one of the biggest concerns that the Committee on the Status of Women have. It's not just for women, number one, and it's not just for faculty. It's across all the spectrums.
The Women's Center provides educational programs as well as a resource of support for young women on campus. The center hosts a Take Back the Night rally to further awareness of sexual and domestic violence and its prevention.
Keith Williams of the Center for Independent Living earned his master's degree at Scranton.
I was a student here. I started the graduate program in the Human Resources Administration division in the fall of 2002. And I finished, I graduated in spring of 2005. And an opportunity opened up for a small group from the university, a multidisciplinary approach. Professors from different departments, and they asked me if I would be interested in going on a trip to Mexico City to conduct some guest lectures with them through the Universidad Iberoamericana, which is the sister university of the University of Scranton. And I jumped at the opportunity. The school was great about helping put all the logistics in place, the travel, the hotel, everything, and we were there for a week, and it was a great experience. The Americans with Disabilities Act, or ADA for short, the ADA Task Force was established by the university several years ago, and they asked me to participate.
In 1992, I was given the assignment of helping make the University of Scranton accessible to ADA guidelines. Another location where I think we're on our third pool lift that's been installed because we've had them in there since the early 90s. And we have a pool lift over there that now does meet the more recent ADA guidelines for pool accessibility.
For several years, I go for swimming exercise once a week at the swimming pool in the Byron Center. And there was a recent upgrade within the past academic year to the mechanism, the lift, that helps get me and anyone else with a disability in and out of the pool, in that there is now an electrically operated hydraulic lift where someone can transfer from their wheelchair the mobility device onto a seat, and then the seat will lower and then rise out of the water so that they can transfer back into their chair.
So the 13th Annual Northeast Disabilities Conference will be October 29th, 2014.
The first conference was on transition, and that was really important because Mr. and Mrs. Leahy wanted to focus on children and on the needs of children, and they also wanted to celebrate nurses, occupational therapists, physical therapists, teachers, counselors, correct, the people that really provide the services that individuals with disabilities need to lead productive lives.
One of the things that we make sure that the conference offers continuing education unit credits, CEUs. Our office on campus, Human Resources, actually with SHRM, made sure that people who are seeking how to hire people for employment so that Human Resources is represented. It's really been an evolution over the years. Some of my favorites have been the veterans and vocations. The big 10th anniversary celebration, I think, will always go down as one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. One of the pillars, though, of this conference is really employment and having every individual with a disability to be self-sufficient.
Right. We have counseling for licensure and for the different certifications. We also have Act 48 credits for our teachers. And there's also a certificate of attendance so that if folks are coming from OT or PT or nursing, they can then submit this to their professional organization for CEUs.
It's unique and individual, and stop looking at the dis, but looking at the abilities. So Pope Francis, a Jesuit, really goes back to the founder of the Jesuit Society, St. Ignatius of Loyola, who was a wounded soldier, and he had a disability, and that was in the 15th century. So you really, we've come almost historically full circle.
The Center for Teaching and Learning Excellence provides services for students with disabilities as well as faculty education.
I think one of the most difficult things for students that we work with is when their disabilities are invisible. Okay, it's obvious when you see a person in a wheelchair that this person has disabilities. But a person with learning disabilities, there's nothing visible. So when we worked with these students, we could help them develop their approach to studies using their strengths and kind of putting their weaknesses off to the side. You know, often the accommodations students were given were the accommodations they had in high school, and because that's what was in the reports, the IEPs and the things they brought with them. But as the professionals worked with us and pointed out to us, often these are not the best accommodations in college, that things need to be more appropriate for the age they're at now. So that basically how we got the disability piece when we became the Center for Teaching and Learning Excellence.
In 2011, we found that there were students on the autism spectrum on campus that were having difficulty with the social aspect of campus life. And collaboration with Barbara King, we contacted the Center for Independent Living, who has an autism specialist on staff, and we began discussing about what they could do for our students. So the Center for Independent Living applied for a Weinberg Foundation grant, and they used the funds to work with students from the university, McCann, and they had a couple of students at Penn State Worthington. And the purpose of the grant was to work with students that are high-functioning autistic students who needed help with everyday life, that living here independently on campus, they could work with them and help instill skills to help them once they went into the job market. Most times these students were going into the job market, but they weren't given any skills to take with them. Well, they thought that working with them while they were in college, living independently, that they can help them, especially deal with some of the social situations that they have difficulty with.
I've taken different courses that have helped me accept my disability as well as help realize how I can help other people with disabilities. One of the major courses I took here was Exceptional Lives, which is an education course, and Dr. Tallarico is the professor of that. And while I was taking that course, I was one of the only sophomores at the time, and the rest were freshmen. But she just kept talking about like how different disabilities are, and she had guest speakers come in. So when we came up with the hearing section, I went up to her. I've never actually talked in front of people about my hearing losses. I never really accepted it, but I figured what better way to accept it than talk about in front of a bunch of people that accept disabilities and are going to be working with people with disabilities. So I talked to her and she let me get in front of the class and go through my experience, and it really helped me accept my disability. That was the first time I was actually able to say I have a disability. So that course has not only helped me grow, but it helped other people grow, because having me talk about my disability has helped other kids realize to accept their disability. So that was a very cool experience.